Shirt, Adrian. How's everybody doing? This is Jose Trujillo. I am the world's greatest living artist, kicking some butt left and right, low and high, back and forth. So I'm gonna talk to you guys about something cool right now. How's it going, Craig? Why can't I just... What do I have to, like, chew these things? As soon as I put them in my mouth, I want to chew them. I don't take my time. I don't savor them. I just, like, just want to chew them. So, guys. How's it going, Kim? Man, these things are good. I'm gonna talk to you guys about something cool right now. Coming to you from the car studio. Yes, you heard me right. This is the car studio. Yeah. All right, here we go. Let's get this thing started. So I was listening to my man Gary Vaynerchuk talk about some entrepreneurial stuff. The Gary Vaynerchuk. Smart fellow, man. Very smart guy. Let's talk about being an entrepreneur and whatnot. It got me thinking. Look, this is what he said, okay? He said, many of you out there, somewhere along the lines, because I don't remember exactly. I'm going to give you a loose translation of what I heard. Many entrepreneurs out there get to a point where you have a bit of success, right? Maybe you came from not having much. Some of us came from nothing. Some of us came from having something. Some of us, you know, I don't know, whatever, right? But let's say that you came from not having much. And you roll up your sleeves, you know, and you start working hard, and you put everything into it, you put your back into it, and bam, you start creating some sort of success, right? You start creating some sort of success, I don't know, whatever that is for you. And he goes on to say, look, it's so interesting that they go, these people, right, go into... From having very little to kicking some ass and making some success to being afraid. Almost like if they're afraid of losing something, right? It hit home with me. This is something that Gary Vaynerchuk said. It hit home with me. Well, I'm saying this. It hit home. Because I know I've done this many, many times. What a lot of artpreneurs or entrepreneurs or whatever the fuck people call themselves... Artpreneurs, I think. I don't know. Some ridiculous shit. A lot of artists who are looking to be sustainable, right, have done this. I see that a lot. I've done it. Where, look, instead of... Because now there's a little bit of income coming in. Instead of pushing forward, what starts happening... is that we go into conservation mode. I'm so afraid because now I got the new car. Oh, I'm afraid. I'm afraid because I got the nice place now. You know, maybe you weren't doing well, and then you started creating some income, and now you have something that you could lose, right? Now you have something you can lose, and I don't blame you. I get it. I've done it. Shit, I still do it. You know, but I thought it was so insightful when he said, look, it's interesting because now they're in a place, right? The entrepreneur that's making, I don't know, whatever you feel comfortable with a year, making X amount, now is afraid of losing that instead of realizing that now you're in a better place. where you can actually make some moves, hire some people, right? Pay some ads, grow your business, do something bigger, do something better. Now you're playing the conservation game. You're trying to conserve. It's a huge problem. I always talk about huge problems. I don't always talk about huge problems, but you know what I mean. And this is what artists do. You know, an artist starts making a little... I don't even think it's just artists, right? But because I see artists all the time. I talk to artists just about every day. I got an email that says, dude, I started selling some artwork, blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, oh, okay, great. Okay, cool. Buy some Facebook ads, okay? Or some Google ads. And make yourself a list, an email list. They're like, oh, man, well, how much is going to be that? Who cares how much is going to be? Now you're selling artwork. You weren't selling artwork before. Now you're selling artwork. Put some in there. Because overall, it's going to help you tremendously. But see, but we don't do that. We don't do that. We start making a little bit of income, and we go... People start putting it away, which is like... I'm not going to give you guys, like... talk about... economy here, because I'm not an authority, first of all, but I'm not. It's just shit that I don't do, right? I don't go try to put money away first. What I do is that I'll get the income that I got from my artwork, and I shove it right back into the machine. I shove most of it right back into the machine, and that has been able to give me an advantage over a lot of people out there creating artwork or trying to copy me or mimic me or doing the same thing that I'm doing, is that I'm not playing with it, right? If I sell three paintings, one goes to the cost, right? Another one goes to be put away, like to the cost of running the show. Another one goes to putting it away, and another one goes right back into marketing. And the cost and marketing are very much associated. I consider a lot of marketing cost, because that's how people saw it in the first place, right? That's how people were able to see it in the first place. Otherwise, they can't buy it. So I see this as a huge problem with a lot of artists. Like they sell a $1,000 painting, and then they're like, oh man, I'm gonna put this money away, or do with the money, whatever, right? I don't care. It's I'm not gonna get into that. It's your money. What I'm trying to say is, if you want to continue playing the game, it would be very wise of you to get some of that income and market yourself even further. Maybe get some of that income and hire someone. Like, start making moves. Now, you're barely starting out. If you're like just getting started, get some of that income and buy materials right away. Don't get some of that income and go hang out or buy yourself a nice expensive watch. Now it's not the time. I think that now the time is to shove it right back in there. Again, I'm not an expert on this whole money thing. Okay, I'm figuring it out. I'm figuring it out myself too. I have a couple of mentors that I'm working with, but I see this over and over, you know? I see this over and over. Like, as soon as things are happening, now we go into conservation. Like, we start conserving. This happened to me really bad when I was starting out. I started selling artwork in galleries. And the same as I started selling the work, money started coming in. What I started doing was that I wanted to conserve. I wanted to play See, you try to outsmart right away. I try to outsmart. You know what I mean by that? You're looking for ways. This is what I did, okay? As soon as a little bit of money started coming in, I started looking for ways where I didn't have to... where I could outsmart the situation and not work as hard. This is right in the beginning. This is a huge challenge that artists face. I know it. I've seen it over and over. An artist sells a painting, and then they're looking for, how do I make prints? No, go sell another painting. Like, they're looking for ways to outsmart the situation too early. In other words, they're prematurely trying to delegate things they should not delegate. Prematurely trying to not necessarily cut corners. They're not trying to do that. They're trying. They make a good sale and they want to go play golf. You know, they make a good sale and they want to chillax. And that's it's not going to work that way. You make a good sale. What's the next best thing to do in that moment? Go make another great sale. Like, go and do another exhibit. I don't know. You sold something on Facebook, on eBay, on Etsy, whatever. Put something else again. Double up on it. You sold one thing. Now list three more things. Like, it's I don't know. It's something I did. And when I heard Gary Vaynerchuk talking about it, I was like, oh, man, I get it. I get what this cat's talking about. In a micro, right? Because the guy's, like, moving millions. Maybe hundreds of millions. I don't know. The guy's, like, moving a lot. But me in my little old, my little micro experience I'm having as an artist, I can see that, right? I can feel that. I can feel that you're not going to win by playing off defense, is what I'm trying to say. In other words, you're not going to win at the game by playing defense. You know, it's not. You're not going to win by evading, or I don't know if that's the right word, punches. You know, no one wins a fight that way. And most people are trying to outsmart the situation, and they're like, oh man, if I can conserve myself and you know, and hide or block myself, only Mayweather wins fights like that. The way that you win a fight is by punching more and harder than the other person. Probably faster, probably more, and probably harder, or a combination of all three. No one wins by you know, playing defense. It doesn't work like that. Not in real life. It doesn't work like that. But that's what we do. As soon as we start getting a little bit of success, we touch a little bit of success, right away we go into defense. I don't know why. Whatever success is for you. Again, I don't know. I don't know if it could be gallery shows, it could be online, or it could be whatever, right? Whatever. I don't know. Everybody does things different. I know some people just kill it selling prints. And you know, and if I tried, I know that if I tried selling prints, just selling prints, I'd be like scratching my head. Like, where's the money coming from? Right? Because that hasn't worked for me. I have sold them. I know how to sell them. I've made some income from it, like not like a couple of grand. I make some income from it, but I don't know how to make it work continuously. You know, I haven't figured out how to sustain myself just from that. So I just don't do it. I don't spend my energy there. So I have to put it in a scale. Okay, do I get some of that here, or do I just focus on what I know, what I really know, the thing that I know? And what I'm trying to say here, guys, is don't play the defense game. You know, you got to be in offense. You got to be in offense. Now, this is not some sport analogy or anything. It's just life. You know, no one's gonna win by hiding. You don't win by covering your face. You get your teeth kicked in by covering your face. You can't cover your face. You got to punch and kick as well. And it is an interesting thing because before I started making a living as an artist, before I was a full-time artist, I tried to do everything and anything. Man, I would spend my time doing just about anything that could get me to that. Right? I did the art shows. I went on the art fairs, the circuits. I did whatever I could, right? I hung out with the photographers, because photographers tend to know more about selling artwork than artists. I know that. That's a fact. Photographers are very smart. And I think the reason why, it's because they're more entrepreneurial. than artists. Artists kind of like, photographers don't say, man, I don't know. I don't know if I feel like taking a photo. No, because it's like, snap, right? So they don't go through that. I'm sure that they have that as well. They have that artist block or whatever. But I'm not talking about creative, artistic photographers. I'm talking about portrait, wedding photographers, those type of photographers. They're very smart. The ones making a living, they know how to market. They know how to make it happen. You know, and maybe not in a big way, but enough to make a living out of it. And that's the people that I started hanging out with. I didn't hang out with artists. I had it with that. I was hanging out with artists, with other painters and sculptors, and they didn't know what the hell they were doing. Most of them had their head up their butt, including myself. So I was like, whoop, this is not the right room to be in, you know? So I was like, what do I do? And I started noticing that photographers were driving nicer cars than artists, right? And I was like, oh, wait a minute. Now, I didn't go because of that specifically. I didn't go try to meet them because of that. But I did see that they had a more ease. I was like, you're a photographer, right? And they're like, yeah, but I'm not an artist. I'm like, yeah, sure you are. You're creating art. And I'm like, yeah, I'm an artist, but, you know, there's creative in it. As a matter of fact, what I found out, that the ones that were more creative is that you have to be very structured and very, very firm and blah, 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 if you're a portrait or wedding photographer. But I found out that the ones that were more creative, right, they also had the structure, but they were very creative when it came to how they market, how they took the photos. Some of them actually made the photos kind of mimic certain artwork. I learned a lot from them. I learned a lot from photographers. Photographers are very smart. Very smart. The ones succeeding, right? The ones creating success in succeeding. I don't even know if that's a word. The ones creating success in their careers or jobs or whatever businesses are very smart. I learned a lot about Photoshop and different softwares they use. They use a bunch of great softwares. I learned how to use them because of working close with photographers. And anyways, what I'm trying to say is that I love the way these guys think, because as soon as some cash starts coming into their business, they go and spend it in ads, which is mind-blowing, right? If you're an artist, it's mind-blowing. It's like, oh my God, what? No, like, I'm going to go and buy art materials. And you could use the what is this word? The argument that they don't have to buy that many materials or everything. I don't know. I hung out with a lot of photographers, and man, their stuff is expensive. You know, lenses, lights, and backgrounds, and, you know, especially if you go to their studios, like each little thing is so expensive. You know, a lot of them still like to use, you know, some vintage cameras and all kinds of stuff. Yeah, but they're very creative. And also, they print, they have their stuff printed large, because that's where the real money comes from, right? Photographers, their big money comes from large prints. Succeeding is a word. Thank you so much, Kim. I was afraid of that. Thank you. So these photographers, upgraded their stuff, right? As money starts coming in, I saw it with them. As money starts coming into them, they go and they buy the nice suit, right? Because they have to look presentable. They go and they buy the best camera they can, right? Most of them have the best camera they can because they're very passionate about that. But they go and they start buying tools, not art materials. You either become a pro or you don't if you are working in photography as a business. You either become a pro right away or you don't, right? Because it's fast paced. It's like, okay, one wedding here, you know, high school over here, a high school photo shoot, a prom, you know, family milestone, boom. You know, and I was looking at how they move, And it's a business, right? It's a business. So they think different. Even though they're creatives, they think very different. And their artwork, their artwork looks very modern and stuff. You know, their artwork looks I mean, their photographs look like artwork. They look like paintings. They look really cool. Some of them look, anyways, the more it looks like a painting, the higher it costs. It's very interesting for many of them. Some of them look like watercolor wash type of artwork. They just look really cool. They look amazing, right? They put all the clear coats and all this stuff, and some of them put grains on the photographs, textures, right? Different textures and stuff. And you know, people pay for that. People pay more for that than for a painting many times. For if you're starting out toe to toe, if you've been painting for 5 years or 10 years and you're a photographer for 10 years, chances are people will pay more for a photography. It's just the way it is, because it's a service, right? It's more of a service, like you know, prom night, you know, or whatever, prom day or whatever, you know, that's a photograph. Wedding, of course, people are going to pay, you know, they're going to dish out a couple of K, you know, and for the service and to get the mean photograph. So I learned a lot from them. I was looking a lot from them. And the reason I'm saying this is because I started this video by telling you guys what I heard from Gary Vaynerchuk, who said, look, as soon as some people start making some income, generating some income, they go into defense. They start protecting as if they have assets, right? They start protecting like, oh my God, I'm making, I don't know, whatever you're making, right? I'm making 50K, you know, selling my artwork. Let's say that you're doing that a year. I don't know. I'm making this. Oh my God, I'm going to conserve it. How can I conserve it? Because working for a company would be so much difficult. I promise you that 50K for a business working for someone else, it's 10 times easier than earning 50K working for yourself. That is a fact. It's so much easier to get it from a company. So from another place, from a company or somewhere else. People have this idea of working for yourself, but it's very hard. It's very difficult. And anyways, to get back to the photographer thing, I saw how they were very astute, very smart, right? I was like, man, this cats think different. They don't think like artists, even though they are artists. Many of them are artists. Many of them are graphic. They understand graphic design. They understand composition. They understand color theory for sure. Composition, absolutely, right? And many of them know how to draw. They're excellent draftsmen, right? They know how to draw. And I think because they studied art somewhere. I don't know. They studied either studio art or something, and they just went into photography. But I saw that a common thread amongst photographers is that they make it a business right away. Why? Because it's a service. It's a service. It becomes a service. And if you paint happy little trees and happy little flowers like me, it's not a service, right? So you have to figure out how you can make it, how you can get some of those ideas and turn it into a business. How you can get some of those ideas that photographers use or other industries use and apply them to art, to what you do. I've seen some people applying what I'm doing. I probably have to make a video about it, you know, like and really breaking it down. But I see some people applying what I've been doing for, I don't know, for like 6 years now. And just one of the things that I do, which is eBay. It's one of the five things that I do where I generate income as an artist. And it's working for them, you know. I've seen them just do one. If we break it down, which I think I'm gonna do, you can see why it works, because it's not common. It's not common behavior. This is behavior that I learned from photographers. It's not common. It's not common behavior. What I do on eBay is not common behavior. It's not what you expect from an artist, from most artists. These are things that I Frankenstein my way into that, right? Things that I started learning from different industries. For example, no one on eBay was offering an upsell of frame. I see a lot of artists now doing that. I'm not saying this to be cocky or anything, but I know I started that. No one was doing that. The reason I did the adding the frame was because no one was willing to do that. I think everyone was afraid or something. Upselling a frame. That idea, I got it from a seminar. I attended a seminar, a sales marketing seminar. And they opened up the seminar by saying, it was about upsells, right? Would you like fries with that? Would you like fries with that? And that stuck with me. I was like, oh man, I wonder where I can apply that as an artist. Because most people try to upsell a print or some bullshit that has nothing to do with why they bought the painting in the first place. And I was like, what are they going to do once they get this painting? What is the next step people are going to do? Okay, what is the very next thing they're going to do? Frame it. Then do an upsell for that, you know? And in when I do commissions, I think about all these steps. What is the next step that they're going to do? What is the next step? What is the thing they're going to do after framing? What else do what other resources or tools or things are they going to be interested in? And how can I supply that? How can I help to close that, right? So, as an artist, I'm going all over the place today, man. It's because this drive is long. As an artist, you got to think about all of this stuff. You got to think dynamic, you know, in a dynamic, dynamically. Kim, is that a real word, dynamically? you got to think like that. You got to think in different, you know, you seeing things in different and from different perspectives. And create a linear step-by-step approach, right? For example, if you are going to do a commission portrait, let's say I used to do commission, that's how I started. I started doing commission portraits. If you're going to do a portrait commission, you know, you're going to paint someone, what can you offer around it? What can you offer? So one of the things that I noticed was everybody wanted to have a print of the painting. Huh? Bing, bing, bing. I bet you never thought about that. If you're a portrait artist, I bet you never thought about that one. Now I'm just showing off. Everybody in the family, right? Especially the older people, the older generations, they care very much about that. It's very important to them. So, for example, if someone asks you to do a portrait of little Lisa in her tutu costume, right? Because she does ballet. She's a ballerina. I don't know. She's like 12 years old. And everybody, you know, the whole family just adores her, of course. She's the princess of the family. You do the portrait. You paint little Lisa. And only one person can keep it, right? Only one person can keep the painting. So you offer upsells of the painting as limited edition prints. Why limited edition? Because you're not gonna, who's gonna wanna buy a portrait of little Lisa somewhere else? Nowhere else, right? Only the family really cares about that. It was a special connection to the family. So you do a little, I don't know, 5 prints, 10 prints if it's a big family, I don't know. Or maybe you have 3 packages, right? You have 2 prints, 5 prints, and 8 prints or something like that. And these are the 3 different, you know, different price points. Giving you guys all kinds of cool stuff right now. So that's what you do in that situation. Limited edition. Or maybe you do only one print, but you offer 3 different sizes. Why not? Your creativity is what stops you, really. It's how creative you get. and shameless about it, right? You have to be shameless about it, because if you're like, oh my God, no, they're not going to want it because, you know, they only want the one of a kind. Of course they want one of the one of a kind. The parents want the one of a kind. But the grandparents can't have the one of a kind. So what do? You offer something to them as well. Another thing that I did too is that while visiting Disneyland, I took notes. Yes, I was working when I was in Disneyland. Just about every year, I take my family to Disneyland to hang out, you know, because my wife loves Disneyland. It's kind of grown into me too now, but she absolutely loves Disneyland, and we're like really close here in Arizona, because, you know, it's in Anaheim. So while I'm walking around, you know, in Disneyland, I'm like taking notes. I remember taking like a little pen and paper, like sitting down, you know, when it was like, oh, I'm tired, and just writing down how amazing this person is to create value and offer value to the people that are there, right? Because he's offering an experience, right? Walt Disney is offering an experience. The Disney, I don't know what it is, Industries Corporation, whatever it is offering an experience to the people. It's a whole experience, and that's what people buy. When they buy your artwork, they can buy your artwork. They're buying an experience. Even if they love it, it's an experience. It's there's a connection to it, right? They're adding to their experience in their life. They're adding to their to every time you consume something, you're adding to your experience as a person. Just think about it. Every time you're in a you go have dinner, the appetizer is a pre-experience to the dinner, right? You order the dinner, right? The appetizer and the drink, let's say that you drink wine or whatever, anything you drink, it's a pre-experience. It's a savory experience, that it's an anticipation. It's an anticipation. It's a savory anticipation of your dinner. The music in the background, the nice painted walls, the nice comfy chairs, the smile on the waiter or waitress, you know, the light candle on the table to dim the lights, because dim lights, right, they're an experience. They're an experience to the senses. It is all an experience. The dessert at the end of the dinner is an experience. Thank you, blah, 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 come again. That's an experience. You're being greeted, and someone opens the door to you for you when on your way out. It is all intended to add to your experience, right? Because you wanted to have a good night dinner with your family or with your loved one or whatever, right? A friend, a coworker, whatever it is. You wanted to have a good experience. And this added, right? Hopefully it's not a coworker, because I was talking about romantic stuff. hopefully it's just your partner, okay? but it is meant to add to your experience. And then at the end of that, you know, you go to the valet to pick up your car. The valet greets you, smile on their face. Yes, sir. Well, they talk to you like you're the boss, because you are the boss in that moment, right? Yes, yes, boss. Absolutely, boss. Blah, blah, blah. Let me get that door for you. Let me get that door for your lovely lady, you know, or whatever, right? Let me get that door. And on and on and on, and it's adding to your experience. Right? If the valet works for the restaurant, if it's a hired gun from the restaurant, they're adding, they're extending your experience. Why am I saying all of this crap? Because this is consumer behavior. Everything is like that. We don't need things. They are experiences in our life. No one needs poetry. We say at our core we do, right? No one needs art at our core we do, but it's not necessary. It's not like soap. It's not like soap. Like I need it to wash my body, right? It is to enhance our experience as human beings. Cleanliness is also that. The soap is the same way. Otherwise, we wouldn't buy different brands of soap. Some of them smell different, you know. And on and on and on. It is intended to extend your experience as a human being, to heighten or highlight the day or whatever, you know. So anyways, I think I went far with this one, and I'm good and all over the place today. I like it that way. Sometimes I'm all over the place. So anyways, guys, let me know if you have any questions or if you're just completely puzzled after this video. Let me know. DM me your questions. If you guys have any questions, I'm still doing the 15-minute consultation, free one-on-one. DM me your phone number or whatever. I'm not going to bug you. I'm just going to call you for the 15 minutes. We'll set up a time if you're in a different part of the world. We'll set something up. We'll Google it and figure out what time zones you are, or what's the best time to call. And if you're into that, if you're into trying to get your artwork out into the marketplace, learn how to market and on and on and on, let me know. I'm all about that. I'm doing it myself. I recently hired some people in my studio. That I'm happy about that. Oh, I want to take this moment to apologize to the people I haven't sent your artwork to yet. I'm really sorry about that. I apologize for that. Carol says, great thinking. Thank you so much. Yeah, I just got two more people to help me package artwork because the two people that were doing it, it's too much for them. So I got two more. So now there's four of us packaging. Well, not me, but there's four people packaging artwork. I jump in there from time to time, and I'll help package as well. But now there's four people, so it's going to go faster. Okay, your artwork, you're gonna get it there faster. I apologize if you haven't gotten it yet, and it's been like, I don't know, 2-3 days after. Please forgive me. I appreciate very much your patronage and your patience. It's always valuable. It's how I run my studio, so thank you so much for that. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to send artwork your way. It matters a lot. It means a lot. It's just it's a good thing, you know. We're honored also to send work your way. It's always an honor. It's always an honor when somebody really loves a piece of artwork enough, you know, to want to exchange value with me for it. I think it's always something that makes me, it just makes me very happy. I always feel honored because of that. It's like the highest honor, you know. I get to paint and then someone's like, here, let me give you some of my value, some of my hard-earned cash, right? Let me give you some of my value for your value. It's always beautiful. So thank you so much for that. And one more thing, because this might go to YouTube. Those of you who are watching on YouTube later, guys, the videos, the courses for painting courses, marketing courses, eBay courses, they're coming out. I'm going to go after Etsy now, because I haven't done Etsy, and I'm going to kick some ass in Etsy. Watch me. I'm going to own Etsy. I'm going to be the artist of Etsy. So watch out, Etsy out there. People doing stuff on Etsy. I'm coming. There's only room for this cowboy. No, I'm just joking. There's room for all of us. But I'm very aggressive with it. So here I come. As soon as I figured Etsy out, because some of you have been asking me about Etsy, I don't have authority on Etsy. I've never done it. I've been there, but I've never been there. Watch me be there now. It's a different... it's a different platform, of course, than eBay, but I'm gonna crush it. I go deep into everything I go, so I'm going to learn it. I'm gonna kick some butt. I'm going to make it work. I'm not gonna ask permission to it. I'm gonna make it work. Yeah, and I'm gonna put together a course right away. As soon as I start monetizing on Etsy, I'm gonna put a course together for you guys, and I'm gonna walk you through step by step how I did it, because I'm gonna do it this year. I'm gonna do it right away, it's not going to be hard. I understand that it's a different platform, but essentially all platforms are the same. It's not going to be difficult, and I'm gonna show you guys how I did it. I haven't even done it, and I'm already promising you I'm going to show you how I did it, because it's not a walk in the park, but it is not impossible either, and I'm going to show you how. The other thing too is that my website, where you guys are going to be taking these courses, those of you who want to take the courses, I'm going to do marketing for beginners, intermediate, and for the pros. All of you guys out there wanting to learn how to use Facebook ads and on and on, Google AdWords, how to use influencers and some very cool stuff that I've learned along the years, along the way, how to work together with other people. And I'm not talking about Instagram influencers. I'm talking about people that have businesses, and how do you monetize there? How do you exchange value, real value? Right, a win-win, not a please sell my painting and then I'll give you 50% of it. That's not real value. Their hands are full with work. I'm talking about giving them something that they can't, an offer they cannot refuse. I know how to do that kind of stuff, okay? And I do it all the time. I got some stuff. People scratch their heads and are like, man, how do you make eBay work? It's not just eBay, guys. It's a bunch of stuff. It can't just be one thing. It's a bunch of stuff. So it all combines. And I'm gonna do courses for all of you guys with the different facets, the different angles of it. Because it's not just one. It can't just be one strategy. Because what if that changes? It's got to be multiple strategies. It's got to be multiple things. I'm still figuring out Instagram. I'm not as good as on Instagram as I want to be, but on Instagram, what's really cool right now, how's it going, Ariga? On Instagram, what's really cool and what I'm using a lot is the stories, right? This live, the Instagram live and the Instagram stories. It's killer. It's really cool. So many people have been contacting me through Instagram. A lot of people DM me on Instagram. It's really cool. And the likes and the follows and that kind of stuff, I still don't get, guys. So I apologize if I'm doing like, if I'm not nailing it, if I'm not getting back to you guys, if I'm not following you back, I still don't get it. I got someone to help me, and I don't think that they're doing a great job. I already got two people to help me, but they're supposed to be pros. So if you're listening, pros, I'm not very happy yet. So, but anyways, I'm going to figure it out. I'm going to make it work. And it's good. It's going to be good. We're going to go from there. Kimberly, for the courses, I will be charging for the courses, but I'm going to do some freebies. I think is that even a word? Freebies? Free ones? Freebies? Freebies? I'm going to do some freebies to get you guys started. Because you know, I think it's cool. It's taking so much time. So much time for what, Ariga? I'm sorry, I didn't get it. Kimberly says, are you charging? Oh yeah, charging for the courses. I will be charging for the courses. I'm gonna charge for the more intense courses, because some of the courses I'm gonna take you by the hand and I'm gonna walk you right through content creation, Facebook, and on and on. Oh, Instagram. Oh yeah, Instagram is taking. Yeah, Instagram is kicking my butt right now. But you know what? At the same time, it's really working for me too. I get to connect with so many of you. I get to connect with so many of you. So while I haven't gotten the handle out of getting, you know, a million followers as I want to, I haven't gotten a handle out of that one. Nevertheless, I don't stop trying to connect with you guys. So on a daily, I'm doing, you know, I'm shooting 2, 3, 4, 5 videos sometimes a day on Instagram live, you know. And that's, that alone, if you just do that, if you're an artist, if you just do that, that alone is going to help you, just because you're going to start connecting with people. You want to create connection. You want to create connection because it's all about exchanging value. Some people want to know how I do Facebook ads. Some people want to know how is it that I got to have 12,000 fans on my fan page. Some people want to know that, you know, because at the end of the day, if you're an artist and you know that, that's money in your bank. That's what it is, you know. Some people don't like to talk about this kind of stuff. I do. I talk about this stuff all the time because it's an exchange of value. This is what this is how the world runs, in value exchange. You know, nobody gets upset about the doctor. If I go to the doctor and I'm like, dude, my teeth, or the dentist, right? Or dude, my leg. Like, nobody gets upset. Nobody says, oh, you know, oh, that doctor always fixing me up. Nobody says that. They're like, thank God, man. Thank God for the doctor. You know, thank God for this or that. You know, yeah, it was expensive, but then again, it was worth it because otherwise I didn't want to lose my leg. Ha, 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 ha. Thank you, doctor. You know, nobody says, like, nobody gets upset. So I encourage artists to be shameless about being real. You know, be real. Be shameless about it. Like, you are exchanging value. As an artist, you're exchanging value. Someone out there loves, or many people love what you do. They absolutely love the artwork you do. There's collectors for everything. Some people hate my stuff. Some people love it. You know, there's collectors for everyone. Some people hate my stuff and they still buy it. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Hola, senor. Huh? Gavin Hursley, spot two.
Hola, I'm in a live, senor. Dude. Hold on. Give me five. Oh, you left me hanging up alive. Dude, that was ruthless.
I was trying to grab something.
What are you trying to grab?
A tablet.
Can I have five now?
Yes.
Yeah, that's like more like a four. You had a good day?
Yeah.
All right, guys, I'm going to leave you now. Thank you so much. Just picked up little Daniel. Little Daniel, say hi.
Hola, senores and senoritas and both.
Leslie says, oh my God. About being real, shameless for being real. Yeah, you gotta give that a try. We gotta be shameless about it. There's just so many people that don't want you to do things because they feel bad about doing them. You know, there's people that are like, oh my God, dude, I can't believe that. Someone told me you're just a salesman. You're not even an artist. I'm like, dude, shut up. I've been painting for over 20 years. It's about time I start charging for some of the stuff that I do. You know? And you should too if you're an artist. You should start charging for the stuff that you do. You should start exchanging. Right? Get some value. Get some value. We all deserve it. You put a lot of hours and work and sacrifice into learning how to do things, into creating your artwork. Get some value out of it. Charge people for it. It's okay. It's a good thing. It's a good thing. They're going to receive something awesome, and you're going to give something awesome. Just always, here's my rule of thumb, okay? Always give more than what you're asking for, though. And my rule is that I give much more value. For example, a video like this where I just shoot out value, content, great value, awesome tips, how to sell artwork, how to monetize, how to deal with procrastination, and on, I'm not charging anything for it. See, I always try to give much more. Much more. My rule of thumb is give 10 times more than what you're asking for. It's the right thing to do. I'm asking for your precious time. I am asking for that. I'm asking for your precious attention as I exchange value. But I'm not asking to monetize from it, right? When I do these videos, I try to give as much value as possible. So I'll leave you guys with that. My name is Jose Trujillo. I am the world's greatest living artist. My son just started watching YouTube, so I gotta go. Bye.